Hey everybody, welcome to episode 53 of FoundersGyan, where we bring you the inspiring story of a startup and the founders behind the same. This week our guests are Mayank Panka and Purnank Prakash, the founders of Tacnik, that is TACNIK.com. This is a platform that aims to be a one-stop solution for all your gaming needs. We'll get into this in more detail on the show. We also get into some details about how they used data analytics for their own startup to scale it up to where they are now, and some tips on how you can use the same too. Also, do check out the show notes over at foundersgyan.com/EP53 for links to all that we talk on the show. Finally, stick around till the end of the show to hear some questions about IP registration for startups. This segment is brought to you by our good friends over at Marcas. All right, let's get on with the show now. Okay, today's guests on the show are two young entrepreneurs, Purnank Prakash and Mayank Panka. They are the founders of Tacnik, T-A-C-N-I-K, a gaming rental portal. Purnank is the head of product and strategies and UI developer at Tacnik, while Mayank is the head of business and marketing. Thank you so much, guys, for taking a break from playing games and joining us.
Thank you, Ram.
It's a pleasure, Ram.
Okay, first things first, let's clear this out of the way before we get into anything else. What's your favorite game?
FIFA, hands down.
Same here, FIFA. So it's our routine actually. At the end of the day, after all the work is done, we play FIFA.
Okay, great. I used to be a gamer when I was young, and these days I don't get the time to play games much because my daughter jumps in and she says she wants to play and she doesn't know how to play. So I used to grow up on a very unhealthy dose of Doom and Wolf 3D. That used to be my entry into games, and then I played all sorts of games, right from I used to play all those Test Drive on the PC. If you guys remember Test Drive 2, Test Drive 3, these are all much, much before graphics and things like that. So I used to be a big gamer.
It seems to be before NFS Most Wanted 2.
Yes, right? Yes. It's much, okay, much before that.
Road Rash times, I suppose.
Much before Road Rash.
Oh, okay.
These are 90s and early 2000s, I'm talking. 90s, late 90s, okay, is what I'm talking about.
So that tells us about the history of gaming. Like that, gaming is in Indian culture already.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I very clearly remember this site. You guys should check it out if you don't know. The Underdogs, there's a website called The Underdogs. It keeps changing from .net, .org, whatever.
Okay.
It has a listing of hundreds or maybe thousands of classic games, all types of games, right from genre A to genre Z.
You can buy games from there?
Or? No, it's more of a review site.
Okay.
Some of these games don't have copyrights, so there are download links. Other games, you can look at the pictures, and if you're interested, go in Google and search for the games. But most of these you can't play on your PC these days, because your PC is way too fast, so you might need some emulators or whatever. So enough with talking about games. Let's get into your background quickly.
Okay.
Tell us about your background. Both of you can just take a minute or so before we get into the more juicy stuff.
Both of us are pass outs of NIT Trichy. I did it in civil engineering, while he has a computer science background. I hail from Delhi, brought up there, and he's from Varanasi.
So other than that, like previously, when we were in college, so we had a small venture there. So we used to sell t-shirts. So that time we had that entrepreneurial bug. So when we came to Bangalore, when our job got us here, then we were like having a couple of beers together, and we thought like we have this thing in ourselves, so might give it a chance. And we have been pro gamers from our college times. So we always like, whenever we get time, we try our hands on FIFA, Counter-Strike, Road Rash, anything. So while having those couple of beers, the idea struck, okay, fine, we can do something in this gaming world. And from there, we started talking about it, and this idea came up.
Okay, let's tell our listeners about the concept of Tacnik. What does the name mean?
first of all. And it's, what, explain to our listeners.
So Tacnik is basically derived from the Sanskrit word Tacnik or even the English word technique. The idea behind Tacnik or Tacnik by definition is to do something in the most appropriate or way where you save time, energy and your resources and ensuring the best efficiency. So that is how, you know,
example is playing FIFA in your shorts.
No. So here we have to go in further and deep.
Yeah.
Okay.
So gaming is not about just installing into your system and playing it. You should know the basics of gaming, the hints in that, how to play it more efficiently, so that you can
advanced
beat
techniques.
Other gamers.
Hacks, maybe.
Great. And also, yeah, explain to our listeners what you guys do. I mean, rentals, selling of games, etc., right?
So initially we started with renting out games, consoles, and television. So because we noticed that a lot of people wanted to rent out consoles but couldn't because they didn't have a television. So we started,
television in the sense for the games.
Yeah, just for the consoles.
HDMI.
Yeah, output. HDMI. Oh. 32-inch LED TV. You can't rent it separately, just the television. So, I'll give you a little background how we started.
Sure.
So, when, like Purnank said, when our jobs got us to Bangalore, you know, we decided that we should continue gaming. We were playing it in college. So we bought a console, a PS3 through OLX. Reason being, the consoles are a little on the expensive side. Plus, there are after purchase expense of buying each game.
And so, when you have 40,000 salary, you can't buy 40,000 console.
You guys are officially my enemy because I never played PS3. I always used to like Xbox.
Oh,
we will take that afterwards.
Now we have a perspective for both.
Okay. We have to duke that out. Okay.
Definitely.
Surely.
Go on. So you bought the console.
We bought a PS3 and we got a game FIFA 15. So, but the problem was that the console had some issues and it broke only after a couple of weeks of the purchase.
Wow, okay.
It had some HDMI connectivity problem or something like that. So we contacted the seller, but he denied taking any responsibility for it. You know, we were left stranded. We made an investment and now it stands nothing. We contacted him. He denied any responsibility and then it struck. There isn't any solution for the gamers out there who want to play when they move to a new city, or even if in general they are staying in the same city. You can't, there are no platform where you can rent out consoles and the games, and people are going to gaming lounges and playing on an hourly basis. So people need affordability and convenience, you know, and it's gamers are a really passionate bunch of folks.
Yeah.
So that is when, you know, then that incident came up that we were having a couple of beers and we decided, yeah, okay, this is something we really want to do. Plus, there was a inbuilt passion within us for the game. So that just was like, you know, a trigger or a catalyst.
And moreover, we found out that the retirement age of a gamer in India is 21 years.
Wow.
And
like me, I retired a little late, I think.
And in America, if you find out, it's 35 years, the retirement age.
Not the retirement age, this is the average age.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
So
yeah.
What happens here is that people don't know about it. So in college, when you're there, people talk about Counter-Strike, FIFA and everything. But when you come to job, nobody talks about, like, did you play this game? No, nobody talks about that. Because there's no enough information about it. When you also go to a local vendor and talk to him, Bhaiya, do you have any game which I can play this month? So he has no idea about it. He said, okay, fine, I have 3 games of 4,000 rupees. So like that, he will answer you. So he won't tell you exactly the name of the game. So that when we thought, already people who want to game, they don't have enough resources to play. There is no rental platform or even from a store if they can go and just play there and come back. Like gaming lounges, I'm saying.
Right.
So if there are gaming lounges, they cost you like 200 rupees per hour. So if
right.
you're playing there for 5 hours, then it's already 1,000 rupees.
Right.
And the people who wants to game, they don't have any platform to know about it. IGN being an international platform, it's not much famous in India. So then we thought, this is exactly a problem in our Indian gaming culture and we have to do something about it.
Okay, excellent. Fun fact, like I kind of struck me when Mike, you were talking about how gamers are passionate about their things. So I was in Australia and I bought my Xbox console there, and I carried it all the way back to India in my luggage because it was very expensive. Like you say, in Australia it was like $250, which is roughly about 12,500. But I think the same Xbox 360, I believe, here is 25,000 or something. You know, so I think you are right that gamers are really a passionate bunch and
true, they are like,
to the core.
Sorry?
To the core,
yes, exactly. Now, let's talk about inventory. Mm-hmm. So, how did you manage the inventory when you started the whole thing? Obviously, you just touched on the very fact that a console is very expensive, but if you have to rent out consoles and games, you can't just have one console. You should have like some kind of inventory. So, talk to us through that process. How did you guys manage to build the inventory?
Okay, I'll say a point here which you might not like. The thing was that since we were bootstrapped, we started with our savings, so we couldn't afford to, you know, get all the inventory at the same time.
Right.
So therefore, and being biased towards PlayStation, we started with PlayStation consoles, two each of PS3 and PS4. And we listed out all the games on the website. We had only a few of them, but we didn't put the rest of them out of stock. The idea was to procure the games when our demand arrives.
Right.
So we had we had some sources. I mean, we had contacted people, local vendors, shops, and even if we had to make a loss at that particular time, the idea was to get a game on demand. So we took a time period of 4 hours. So on the website, people can place an order after 4 hours. So like, for example, if it's 12 o'clock, then anytime after 4 we can deliver. So within those 4 hours, we used to arrange those games and deliver to the people. And that is how, you know, we started building the inventory, getting games on demand.
Okay.
So basically the site which was our MVP, most viable product, was had just the products listed there. You can put dates, calculate your rent, and once you're satisfied, okay, I can pay this much amount, then you can give us a call, we'll take your order offline, and then we're used to deliver. So idea then was to just test our idea if gamers are interested in this or not. So once we found out a good amount of traction, people are actually interested about it, so, and we can't take so many calls, orders on calls, so that's when we decided to have a fully automated site.
So let's talk about this ideation process. So obviously you guys were drunk in a bar and so you came up with this idea, but talk to us about the execution. So you just touched on it, Purnank, about how you just had a site and manual orders were processed, but you guys were talking and you decided, okay, this is a good idea. So what did you do to test the waters, so as to speak, before investing in 4 consoles, and how did you promote the site, basically?
This is the drink wala incident is the time of July, I suppose.
Yeah, July.
And then we really liked the idea, we were enthusiastic. So there are 4 of us, as you might know, so we took responsibilities and started validating the idea. We used to go to stores and catch people in front of it and talk to them ki how much do you spend annually on in gaming, what games do you have, what do you do after you're done with a game, if you don't own a console, how do you play games? And then we collected a lot of relevant information and started creating an idea or a business model around it. That is how we started. And then in these 2 months time, Purnank and Ishan started developing a very basic website just to test the idea. And then in September and October, we resigned our jobs, and in November, on Diwali last year, so it's 11/11, we launched the website. We used to, with the 4 consoles that I'm talking about, and then we used to deliver the product ourselves, which further gave us the opportunity to talk to the customers and get again insights, how much are they willing to pay to play on a rented console, what sort of games do they like, Yeah, and then we started adding features to the website. So yeah, one point that we noted was that people wanted to, so let's say a customer rented a console and an RPG game, and he rented it for 2 days but couldn't finish it. So he told me that I want to extend my order, rental order. What am I supposed to do? So later at when we automated the website, we made sure that we had that feature of an extend order button where people can increase the rental period, and there's a strip indicating the pricing.
Different days if you are renting product. So actually our algorithm works in the sense that as you increase your rental period, the pricing eventually will come down for a per day basis.
Right.
So that's where the extend order facility gives a push to the gamers to extend their order. So if they're thinking that I have paid already $700 for 7 days, and if I increase it for one more day, it will cost me just 10 rupees. So they'll go for it. And also is a beneficial thing, because being a gamer, you'll also realize that you cannot predict ahead that you'll be finishing this game up in 5 days. You cannot be sure.
Yeah.
So here a user gets the benefit of choosing it for minimum days from his side, and then he can extend it as much as he wants.
Okay. So one question I think that I think everybody would be very interested in knowing is, how did you guys get the games out in front of, get your website and your company in front of customers?
Okay.
You did a lot of market research catching people. Did you use the same technique to stumbled on the answer.
So I mean, that was the go-to-market strategy. The crowd of gamers is very niche. Very, very niche. I mean, not every person will be gaming. Sometimes people are not, at all interested. And then they feel like gaming is for kids.
Feel like gamers should be put in a separate
Exactly.
prison.
So, wastage of time, money, resources, and all those, hypocrites maybe.
So we went to an event present our idea, and we got the feedback from an elderly person. He said that, why are you ruining our current generation? This is just a waste of time. Those feedbacks
that is the sort of mindset people have, and
To tell you one thing, these reviews are separate, but we have 60 plus reviews on our Facebook page, all are 5 stars, so that gives a push to go ahead with this.
Right, but coming back to the question, I think
we started
get the customers.
We were actually standing in front of the stores distributing pamphlets. We saw that these are the hotspots for gamers, gaming lounges, cafes, and shops. CEX, for example, we used to stand there, distribute pamphlets, stuck posters. Initially, that
outside
is
outside Twide and Indranagar also.
So all these places where we could, find the right crowd, colleges, schools, right in front of them, the bakeries. That is where we stuck some posters, which got us the initial, traction, and then things started taking off from there, because word of mouth has done wonders for us. Because people talk, right? And if you are providing a real good customer satisfaction, plus a gamer really likes you, then he'll definitely go out and tell your friends.
Right.
So and a lot of times, people order multiplayer games. They're offering, they've ordered 4 controllers, and we see that next time one of the other controller guy has ordered from us at his address.
So if you're having a gaming party at your home, you're calling your friends. So that time a friend will ask how you got this console at your place. So you'll tell him, I got it from Tacnik.com. Then you'll again order from his place.
Nice.
Word of mouth has done.
Very nice. I think I'm not sure about this. Maybe you guys can confirm or deny this. But I think in a niche market, word of mouth is very powerful than in a general market. Because in a niche market, so gamers frequent certain forums, certain places.
True.
And I think word of mouth is very powerful.
So to validate this thing, I can tell you the sponsorship money in esports gaming events is huge. Like, it goes in millions, because Ubisoft cannot come and put a hoarding there in Bangalore that Uncharted 4 is coming out. He has to target up certain group of people. So that's where they invest or sponsor the gaming events. So there actually the people are. So that's where, just I'm giving an example how niche is the market. So they have to go to a certain gaming event to promote their company.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it is niche.
Right. Okay. Great. And two things. The cost of rentals. Could you give us just an approximate idea of how much it will cost to rent a console, or again, if there are any gamers listening out there, I'm sure you're going to get some customers.
Sure, if they don't
have their own console, so maybe just give us an approximate idea of the how much it will cost to rent this out. And second thing, I noticed on your site that you don't really have a security deposit or anything. So how do you handle damages?
So initially we had a security deposit, but I'll come to that later. So we have, you know, the rentals are, the prices are kept in, you know, what's the word? Stated, keeping in mind the affordability for the customer. So we start renting out games at 99 rupees.
Yeah,
we
start from 99 rupees.
Game started rupees 99. Console is for what? PS3 is for 499. Same for Xbox 360. PS4 is 699.
$699.
Okay. So that's, I mean, that's really cheap given that people are already spending the same amount of money for a couple of hours in gaming lounges.
Right, and you don't need to travel anywhere.
And moreover, we want to be competitive in pricing. We want to the platform which is giving you the best prices in the market.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we compare our prices with other platforms from where they can get this thing, and we keep it below that itself.
Okay.
So right now, it's our platform is all about getting as many gamers we can.
Okay. And the security deposit?
Yeah. So initially we had a security deposit, 3500 for a PS3, 5000 for a PS4. But we saw that you know, a lot of people came to the website, registered, even added the products to the cart, but didn't check out, didn't place an order. So we Purnank here, since he's the head of customer support as well, he, you know, called those customers up and asked them ki why haven't you placed an order. And we noticed that major chunk of that proportion were students, and those were aged about what, 14 to 15 years, living here in Bangalore. So they couldn't afford to pay that sort of you know,
deposit.
Security. It's really hard to convince your parents that I want a 5000 rupees security just to play games for a couple of days. So that is when we decided that okay, we'll tighten the other aspects of security, but at the same time get rid of the
deposit.
So in that case, what we did is that now we collect the ID, a picture of the ID proof and their local address.
Right.
So that has done fairly for us so far.
And we also have a declaration form where we have all the policies and they have to sign it.
Right.
And we also have, we attach that with their photo ID to keep the proof that this customer.
So any damages can be collected.
Yeah,
So I think that the part you mentioned about people adding things to the cart and then not checking out, I think that ties in nicely with data analytics and the importance of data analytics that we are going to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start with what kind of analytics do you track, maybe, or whatever seems to be the best way to start with, you know? What do you guys think is a good starting point?
Firstly, we like to you know, tell the customers, you know, individual users as well as the, you know, early stage startups, what exactly analytics is.
Yeah, we'll start with that.
And how why is it useful? Why everyone should do it? And why customers shouldn't really be afraid of the word data and privacy?
Sorry, customer, you mean the listeners?
The individual users.
If they're giving some data to our website, so there shouldn't be.
Okay.
The end user
who's
sharing his personal information.
So I would like to start here that the data which we are using here for the privacy, I'll tell you, we are taking just the email ID, the phone number and the address, and we are also tracking what are the games you are looking at our website. So just give you a better recommendation. So next time when you come to our website, you don't have to go through, because we have a huge inventory of games, like over 500 games. You can't scroll all the games to see.
Correct.
So as per your previous viewing, we recommend you the games you might be interested in, these games. So that saves a lot of time for the consumer, and also it is profitable for us, so that we see a lesser number of clicks to place the order, because they've already on their page that this is a product which I'm going to like.
Similar to what Amazon does, you know, when you browsing through, they show you recommendation. So that all of that is data driven, and data is basically analytics is basically collection of data and then putting it. Organizing it and getting useful insights out of it.
Right.
Those insights which you can, you know, implement and convert into strategies and then, you know, so convert it into a build, measure, learn loop.
Yeah. Right. So I'll tell you our current what we are doing. So it has been some 7-8 months. So we have a good number of users on our platform. So presently what we're doing is we are collecting the data, turning into an information base, then setting up KPIs like key performance indicator. And according to that, we are setting up our online strategy, that how we should change our website or marketing, how we should do.
Right.
So, but a lot of our users might be also founders of a company or thinking about it. So, I would like to share our story, our roadmap, how we started the data analytics and how we used to do it previously. So, previously, what we were just an early stage startup, we had very few users. So at that time, it was not possible for us to do the traditional analysis. And the users were so less that you cannot get a data which is significantly gives you a
sample size.
Sample size is very small.
Yeah, very small. So at that time, what is important to do is individual user analysis. Because people miss out on a lot of things. So if you people, what they do is, if they have lesser number of customers, they would call the customer trend, ask them what you forgot, like why you did not place the order, was there any issue. But instead of that, the more profitable or more efficient approach is to do the individual user analysis, in which like there are 3-4 things which a startup has to keep in mind. Is that first thing, if you are doing individual user analysis, then if a customer is coming to your website and you have put some feature, he's doing the whole transaction but he's not using that particular feature X. That means you should you are not giving the value proposition of that particular feature. So there is something lacking in you. And second point which we are doing is that if a customer is cancelling the order, the same with the shopping cart. So we found out that we previously asked the customer why they did not place the order. So the answer was that they did not get the time. But what we found out that people are adding products in shopping cart and they're not placing the order because of the security deposit. As soon as we remove the security deposit parameter from there, they started placing the orders. Those same customers started placing the order. So that time, it was not like that. We were not talking to our customers. We were talking to our customers and we're also doing the individual user analysis to get a holistic picture of whole thing, to make a complete picture of how our user looks as who is using our platform.
Yeah, because at times, you know, individual, but at the same time, you know, when the user base starts to grow, individual user analysis would be of lesser importance. Reasons being, at the same time, talking to customer does not make sense, because a customer might share with you a surface level picture with you, like, okay, I went to this and I did that, but you won't know the microscopic level of it. And you know what, users have a very bad memory. They'll tell you ki, haan, I went there and then this happened, but they wouldn't tell you ki, haan, okay, what part did they miss and all of that stuff. So
they actually believe that they did that, but while talking to them, that might not be the real case. Something else would have happened, and they're just telling you from whatever they can recollect.
Right. So let me just throw in a question here. Now, from what I understand, data analytics is kind of a different beast when it's an early stage startup with very less users, where you have to focus on each individual's actions, versus when your number of users become bigger.
Yeah, then you look into.
Then you have a bigger sample size. Mm-hmm. So, what are the various tools that you kind of use? Is it the same tool that you can use at both the scenarios, or is it like a different tool? What would you recommend our startups to start using?
Surely. And before I come to the part of the softwares, I would like to tell that being an early stage startup, it's very necessary to do individual analysis, customer support, and as well also discuss the idea among the team members also. So how they are thinking about it, and then working on a feature, and then talking to users if if that feature is already not on the website. So this is the first thing they could do if they are an early stage startup. And if as their user base increases, they can go for the softwares like Heap, Google Analytics, then Flurry is there, and then Cloud.io is there. So we are working on all these four platforms, but still none of them are finalized. We are still up with Google Analytics, which we started with, but we have currently implemented Heap, through which we are getting the data. So that is helping us in...
So all these are free tools?
Yeah, so as your user base increases, there might be
some tiered charges.
Uh-huh. But right now, if you're at the early stage, it will be free for you.
Okay. Heap, is it? H-E-A-P.
H-E-A-P. Yeah.
Okay.
And
Heap, Google Analytics, Cloud.
Google Analytics, I suppose.
Yeah,
everybody
it's already, everybody knows.
Cloud.io and Flurry.
And Flurry.
Okay.
And one more thing, Mixpanel is also a good option.
Okay.
So these are things which they can use to do it. And moreover, I would like to add a few things here that whenever you are doing the data analytics part, keep in mind that how your user is behaving to the website and what market you want to target.
Mm-hmm.
If those two things are not in sync, then there is something wrong in whatever the data.
Can you explain what market you want to target?
So see, supposedly if we are marketing to a target of kids.
Right.
So from age of 15 to 20.
Right.
So our whole current market campaign is going through that only.
Right.
But secondly, we have data analytics which is showing us that the users which are coming onto our platform are early stage people.
Right.
Those who are interested in renting only. But the marketing what we are doing is we are targeting kids and we are promoting buy.
Right.
So these two things have to be in place.
Right.
So whatever you are taking feedback from the user analysis, that has to be in the marketing as well.
Right.
So this is the thing I want like people who are working on the analytics part right now to keep in their mind.
And that is where data cleaning comes in. I mean, you know, that is actually ideally the first step of doing the whole data analytics. You first clean the data, remove the irrelevant folks out of there, you know, the outliers and all of that. So if you, Purnank said, if you want to do it for just for the kids, very simple, write a query age between this and that. So that is how you clean the data and then find the relevant deep data mining is the term.
Right.
So do that.
If you like the show, do follow us on Facebook and Twitter. The link is www.facebook.com/foundersgyan and twitter.com/foundersgyan. Both these provide you daily tips and articles as well as resources to help and inspire your startup. There are multiple tips per day. Some examples of these tips would be articles on the latest startups, growth hacking tips, how do you build team for startups, how to get funding, etc. So don't forget facebook.com/foundersgyan and twitter.com/foundersgyan.
Where can we learn more about this? How did you guys learn about this techniques of data analytics?
So this is an iterative process. So we started with Google Analytics only.
My job.
Yeah, so he actually used to do business analysis previously in his job.
Okay.
1.5 years of experience.
Okay, but supposing we have people who...
Who are going to start, right?
Yeah, who don't have this as a background.
There are a lot of... you can take courses on Coursera.org. People might be aware of that. And then there are a couple of books as well for... especially for data analysis. To name a few. My personal favorite is Moneyball. There's a movie based on that.
Moneyball, yeah.
Brad Pitt's. It's actually based on a novel called Moneyball.
Right.
Where, you know, a manager of a club, baseball club, builds a team out of... scratch, and the players have been termed as useless by the other managers and the big companies because of this some flaws, you know, the action of throwing the ball. But this guy has a manager who, you know,
use the data analytics.
Use data analytics to find the conditions that okay, in these circumstances, this player can add a real value to the team.
Right, but Moneyball is a fiction, right, or is it? Does it really help you understand how to use data analytics?
It'll actually make you fall in love with analytics.
Okay.
It won't tell you how to do data analytics, but it will tell you.
Okay, we'll start with Moneyball to fall in love with analytics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then to implement it in a practical way. Any recommendation, any books?
For that, I'm not sure if there are really books to learn analytics, but there are, you know, courses. Like, for example, there, it's again, business analytics or data analytics is a it's a process, and you use languages. For example, SQL,
right.
And then there are softwares like Hadoop,
right.
Adobe Discover, all of that, MySQL, so, and then all these are based on languages, and you can learn those.
And for us, I'll tell you like how we started data analytics. So previously, obviously the user base was less. We launched our website on the first day, so we linked it with the Google Analytics to see, oh god, users are coming, five users are currently online. So that was a very good feeling. So from there onwards, we started catching other numbers. Okay, fine, the users are going to these pages. So I personally don't have any background in data analytics. I'm a coder only. So he has some background, but my personal journey through data analytics was I was looking at the Google Analytics. And
numbers
seeing,
are fascinating.
Yeah, numbers are fascinating. When you are seeing someone crossing this benchmark of placing the order, like if the checkout page is crossed, then one benchmark we have crossed already.
Right.
So those things you get by interacting through Google Analytics.
Right.
So that was our early phase.
Right. Very, very recently only I kind of stumbled upon this, like on Google Analytics, you can actually set goals.
True.
And when people check out, you can see the conversion rate and things like that.
You can,
it's a huge tool, obviously. So there's a lot of work required, and it's an iterative process.
Yeah, it
like
is.
You guys mentioned.
And also new feature which is in beta stage in Google Analytics is cohort analysis, where you can see what is your retention growth rate.
Oh,
so if a user is coming on the first day, did he come back on second day, and how many times did he come back on third day? So you can
over a period of
yeah.
What is the lifetime value of a customer?
Okay.
And with,
nice.
With that knowledge, you can put actions on a website, some new offer every three days, because you are seeing that after first day user comes to my website for 3 days and then he stops coming. So for on first day and third day, you can keep an action, and then user will be triggered to use your website further. So these are very small points which you can read and follow user behavior analysis.
Right. One small question. I know about this because I do a little bit of data analytics myself for my podcast. And heat maps. Which tool do you use for heat maps? Is it useful to you guys?
Actually, I forgot to mention one of these things. So Clicktail is there, where you actually make
the whole video.
Yeah. So heat maps will be there. So the best part of that is, other than pointing out heat maps, it also gives you a recording, like average recording of the session of a user, how user is interacting with your website. So if you get a video, you get a clear picture. Oh, he clicked on the buy section, then he moved on to adding that product into your cart. But he did not go to the product detail page of the game to see the trailer. So there might be some problem with that. So you can make your heat maps there and do the analysis accordingly and change your UI
accordingly.
Okay. And how lightweight are these plugins and tools?
So they are actually lightweight. So they have their own interface already. They give you a snippet which you can put in all of your pages. That snippet gives them the data to their interface.
So you use 4-5 of these tools, your website load speed doesn't change significantly?
See, actually, all those 4-5 tools are not used currently. So what we ensure here in Tacnik is that if one tool is there, then there has to be another tool which is counteracting it. So because you cannot trust only
one
tool, because there might be some change in the backend which is throwing only the good results which you want to see. So there has to be another tool which is testing the same data which you're implementing right now.
To confirm.
Yeah.
Right.
So right now we keep on changing it to see like which one is the best. So as of now we have Google Analytics, Heap and Clicktail in.
So we've used the free trials of all of this.
Yeah.
Okay.
So as you know, bootstrap startup has to go through all the tools to until the phase the product gets expired and you have to pay for it.
Okay. Last question. I think it's been great and it's fascinating learning about all these various tools. I'll try out some of them myself.
True.
You mentioned that recommendations, right? So what tool do you use to generate these recommendations? Supposing a user is browsing.
That's so, our own in-house team.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. It's
so,
your own custom tool.
Yeah. It's basically no tool will tell you that. It's what we're doing is we're collecting the data. I'll give you an example.
Right.
Right. So let's say there are two users on the website, Mayank and Purnank. Alright, Mayank comes to the website and first time when he came, he ordered GTA.
Right.
Okay, next time he came, he ordered a similar game, you know, an RPG. And so, based on that, and Purnank has been using the website for a while now. He's already right. played GTA, he's already played the other games that I'm still checking out.
Right.
So, based on his data, now the business can club us together and say
right.
that, okay, these folks have similar interests. They've
right.
been going to the, you know, through the same phase. So now let's try and see if Mayank, we'll recommend Mayank some game that Purnank has already played and if that intrigues Mayank.
Right.
So they'll suggest me a game and if I click, then that will be confirmation of the hypothesis that yeah, similar people will have similar interests and
right.
that is how,
right.
you know,
recommendation
works.
And it's very
works.
Important to record the success rates, right, of these
otherwise it's
pretty much useless.
As you have much, there is a one big important part in Lean Startup Strategy book that is build, measure, learn, loop. So we follow that. So once we implement something, we take the data, how user respond to it, then we, if it is successful, we go ahead with that. So like extend order option, this is a big success for us. So other than that, there are several features we think of, we implement it, then we test the data, our users, how they are responding to it, and then we make
according to it. I just have one final question back on the same, the tool. So obviously you mentioned that the database, obviously you have to build based on different user profiles, you have to create, but is there any off-the-shelf tools available that kind of is an engine to kind of generate these recommendations? Forget the actual data. I'm feeding in the data, or startups are feeding in data, say user X buys this, recommend Y also. But is there something that will feed in this, or is it supposed to be coded?
Actually, I can't name a company which is doing this as per their full-time job, but there are open source codes available for it. So if you don't want to go through the pain of writing the full code, you can look for open source codes for it. So it's just an API, free API, which you can change the backend code according to your need. And if you don't want to change it, so you just have to pass few data through it, and it will, in the result, it will give you the recommendation for a particular user.
Okay, so thanks for that. I think that was very interesting and kind of deep. Let's talk about plans for expansion. So you did mention that you plan to conduct some gaming events. Is that on the cards? What's kind of like your expansion plans?
So currently we're getting a foothold of, you know, our business in Bangalore, and since our business is really operationally extensive, we can't just expand to other cities and into other verticals overnight, and it'll take time, and I doubt if it'll happen at all without funding in the next few years. The idea is that we'll currently renting out games and selling out games and consoles, everything. So we'll keep the rentals of consoles limited to Bangalore for some time, but since our delivery for games is outsourced, we'll soon, by the end of this quarter, I mean by the end of September, we'll start renting out and selling off games consoles to other cities, beta testing particularly in Delhi and Mumbai, and maybe by the end of March, we'll
in all the metro cities.
All the metro cities.
Well, I'll tell you the reason why a console cannot be scaled to other places right away. Because in the consoles, the people who are renting console from us, they don't have any gaming system at their place. They might be the newbies in the gaming world. So we make ensure from our side their experience is seamless. So because so that we ourselves go to their places, set up the whole thing, then start the game, and if he doesn't know about it, then we play a game with him also, explain all the features, and then you have to see the customer face. He's really happy having the whole setup there, and then we leave from there. So we don't want to lose on that experience, that the feeling which the customer is giving
us. Customer satisfaction.
We don't want to lose that.
Right.
So that's why we first want to have a foothold of consoles in Bangalore, because rental of games is for the people who already have consoles, who already have experience.
And plus, when people don't mind really waiting for a day to receive the game,
right?
So it'll be easy to ship the games from here in Bangalore, and
right.
it'll maybe reach them within 2 days. But this can't be the scalability for consoles would be an issue.
And what about the gaming events?
So for gaming events, we've already been doing that for a while now. I mean, we were launched in November, and we organized an event in December itself. It was through a friend. She works in Mu Sigma, and then there was some annual day there at Mu Sigma. So she just pitched us and said that, okay, you guys can do this. And we talked to the HR, and it was, wonderful. We organized with...
We got very good feedback also.
So it's more of corporate events, right?
Yeah,
not just corporates. We've done events at Extreme Sports Bar. We've done at Frank Anthony Public School here in Indranagar. IIM Bangalore, IISc Bangalore.
Okay.
We've also done one at
Bangalore Airport.
It was a 15-day event, part of their summer.
Mercedes-Benz office, we have already.
Okay, yes, be sure to invite me for the next event.
Definitely.
Free passes for you.
Yeah, thank you so much. But I probably need a little bit of training on FIFA or whatever the game that is.
Okay, nice. We will invite you to our place someday, and then we can have a FIFA round.
Great. Okay, we just have another 2 or 3 questions. I won't keep you guys too much time. So, one question that I ask everybody is like their worst entrepreneurial moment. So, you guys are just about a year old now, so do you have anything that stands out as a very bad or down, very low point in your journey, and the lessons you learned from that experience?
I would like to share. So when the events for the part took off in December, and we had already organized 3 more events in January. So we were really enthusiastic about doing that. So, plus it generates a huge chunk of money. So in mid-Feb, we had an idea that, okay, let's organize a FIFA tournament for the city of Bangalore. So, we focused on the tournament, and we talked to a couple of places where we can organize the tournament. We even got the pamphlets printed, and the prize money was, announced and all of that. But the problem was to gather the crowd. So we were talking to people, and not many people were showing interest. And then we had the 50,000 worth of prize money. So bringing in the money and the sponsorship was a big challenge. So it was just not working out at the whole point of time. And at the same time, the traction for individual rentals started declining, and things were just fumbling, shattering. The tournament was supposed to take place somewhere in third week of March. Just in the first week of March, we decided, this is not something that we want to do right now, because we won't be able to do it at a full scale, and plus at the same time, we wouldn't be doing justice to the rental part of the business, because it had already shown a decline in the traction, and for a startup, a decline in the traction is really, really bad. So that was a breaking point, and but it was very enlightening in a manner that that is when we sat down together and we realized that we want to do this, we're really passionate about this, but let's not get excited and try to do everything all at once. We'll have to keep a focus, be like a race horse, a horse that has those things
blinders.
Around blinders, and just focus on one thing and run in that direction, channelize your energies for that. So then we dropped this idea, and we were doing corporate events again. We did some events in the IIM event happened in April, I suppose, and then this Bangalore Airport one in
May.
But we at that point of time we realized that we need to keep focus, and any startup needs to focus on a single thing, build a single thing at a time, and then add value to it. That is how you should prosecute, because trying to do so many things at a time, I mean, it's just like keeping your foot in two ships at a time.
That's a great point. I think startup should focus. You were about to share something. Was it the same incident?
Actually, whatever Mayank told was actually obviously the highest point of the worst challenges we have faced as of now. So the thing is that for me, that was obviously the worst decision we have taken as of now. But still, the daily process goes like that. If someone comes to you and says this idea won't work, then you feel bad inside. But then you talk to your members, they have believe in the idea, and then you go ahead, okay, fine, I want to do this. This is my idea, this is my company, and I'll make this big. And every time when you have this mindset that this company is going to big, something happens which sets you back, like an investor coming and saying that this idea might not work, there is not a big market for it. So we take this as a challenge. Feel bad. Feeling bad is important, because if you're not feeling bad, then you're not working the right direction. So we feel bad about it. We sulk for 2-3 hours, and then we again go back to work and do something that in another week we feel good about ourselves. Right. Okay, we have faced that challenge and we have overcome that.
Right. It's a roller coaster, right?
Yeah, it is.
Thanks for sharing the case. And also, I think our listeners are not aware of this, but before the call, we were just talking, and before the interview recording, we were just talking, and obviously you shared about some of your early investor meetings where you went for some startup events, and people are saying, "Oh, gaming is not for everybody." I think sticking to your idea and conviction. I mean, if you have conviction in your idea and sticking to that, I think is key. It may not be all. You obviously need to make sure that there's a market, but I think sticking to your idea and guts is really crucial. So I just have one final question, but one more kind of reflecting back question, I would put it that way. Mm-hmm. So Tacnik is 1 year old, and if given the advances that, forget the advances in technology, obviously those are things that happen over the year, but given that all that you have learned over the year, mm-hmm. If there is one thing that you could do different if you start this today, mm-hmm. is there anything that you would do different? What would it be?
I would like to tell one thing. So previously when we started this startup and we're thinking about it, so obviously maturity comes through experiences. So we are now 1 year old in this startup thing, and we know what thing we should do at what time. But at the beginning of the time when we are thinking about the idea, so we did not have any traction or any tangible product, but we still went to talk to people or pitch. So what actually people are doing at this stage, when they think about an idea, they directly go to an investor and talk about it to raise money, and then once they have the money, they will go for implementing the product or whatever the idea is. So that was our also mindset at that time. But then we realized through failures, like obviously if you have an idea, go to talk to an investor, he won't say that I'll invest in your startup, and that actually made us feel bad. So why people are not funding us on this idea? But then we got matured, we talked to other people, we attended seminars, we heard other people, startups, founders talking about it. And then we got to know, no, this is not how the process should work. You should not run behind money. You should run behind your idea. You should run behind your customers. And if the idea is good, if customers are loving it, then eventually everything will fall into places. And if there is an investor, and if you need investment, then we'll get funding. Okay. And we realize this. So that's why we are not in a hurry to raise any investment, but just we are right now focused on customer satisfaction. People should be happy. They should talk about us. 65 five-star reviews should go 6,000 five-star reviews. So that's our target as of now.
Okay. Excellent. I wish you good luck with that. I'm sure the more five-star reviews I'm sure it's like a domino effect, right? You know, you get one good review, the good reviews start, and same with bad reviews. One bad review, you need to stop.
Exactly.
You need to find out what it is and stop the bad. So, before we move on to the final question, how can our listeners get in touch with you? Obviously, I will be putting the website tacnik.com,
and our phone numbers you can put.
And Yeah, how do people get in touch with you guys?
Both of our numbers are mentioned on the website.
Okay, I'll put that on the show notes.
Plus,
are you guys also active on Twitter, Facebook?
Sure.
The social media, LinkedIn, what are you guys active on?
Facebook and LinkedIn, they can contact us through. And if they want to just be in touch with Tacnik, they can message on Facebook.
Yeah, we have a page, a dedicated page, facebook.com/Tacnik.
Right. But you personally,
personally, they can search for Mayank.
Yeah, I will add those on the show notes.
Sure, you can send
that to me offline.
But what I would personally like, if they want to talk to us, give us a call on our number and we'll
feel free.
Great. Excellent. So, we'll move on to the final question. So, before that, thank you so much for spending this time and sharing your knowledge.
Thank you.
So, if there is only one Gyan that you could give, forget everything that you said, it's all erased. Not really, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
Just think that it's all erased. Mm. But if there's only one Gyan, one Gyan that you could give, this is like a bad thing, right? I mean, Founders Gyan, and I'm not able to pronounce Gyan. So, okay, if there's one Gyan.
This is one of those funny books.
Events?
Funny moments. These books. This is a goof that won't be so. If there's one Gyan, only one Gyan that you could give to our would be founders, what would that be? I would like each of you to separately answer.
Okay, since the theme of today's interview was importance of analytics, so I would like to tell all the founders out there that make your decisions data driven. I mean, all of us have opinions, but there's no point unless they're validated. So, and it's not really it's not really that hard to gather information and then make sense out of it. But if you do that, the amount of confidence that you'll have in what you're saying, what you're doing, would be really high, and the chances of success would increase drastically.
Okay, excellent. I just not able to get the quote for everything else there is data, right? We trust in God, but for
everything else there is data.
Yeah.
So okay, great. And Purnank.
So from my side. It won't be on such a micro level. I will give you a broader view about what I think about the startups. And many of the startup people won't agree with me. But what I'm saying here is that if your idea is not changing the culture, then it's not worth. So whatever you do, like there are startup founders who are just doing same business because it already exists. And they know that they can make money in it. So obviously you can become a big person, you will become a big celebrity, you have a lot of money, but that satisfaction won't come inside that you have done something which is not already in the market. The satisfaction which I get here in working with Tacnik is that I am working on something which might change the culture, how people are perceiving gaming in India. So that I want. So one day if like more than whatever the population is playing today video games, if double of that population is playing video games, then I'll be really happy because that happened because of Tacnik. So okay. if you open a new food chain, then people say, okay, fine, this is a food chain. And if you are working on an idea that is creating a culture, people are like crazy about it, then if you're not even earning a single penny, you will be satisfied inside. Maybe. I'm working on something big.
Excellent advice.
You want to say be different.
Yeah, be different.
Be different. Okay, excellent. On that note, we'll close the interviews. Thank you so much once again, guys.
Thank you, Ram.
It was a great pleasure talking to you guys. Great fun also.
Same. Like I had a wonderful time talking to you. It was really good.
Yeah, same here, Ram.
Thank you. Tushar, thank you so much for coming on the show to answer questions with regards to IP, trademark and all those jazzy stuff. If any of you listeners out there have a question that you'd like Tushar to answer, please use the hashtag #AskMarcas, that is #AskMarcas, on Facebook and Twitter, and we will pick out the most interesting questions and answer them in an upcoming episode of Founders Gyan. So thanks again, Tushar, for agreeing to answer some of our listeners' questions.
My pleasure, Ram.
Also, a quick disclaimer. This advice is general in nature. If you have specific questions with regards to your brand or your trademark, we suggest consulting a lawyer before taking any advice that you hear on this podcast. What do the symbols TM and R signify, and when can I use them?
Both the symbols represent the status of a mark and the level of protection it has with them. A TM can be used with any common law usage of a mark or even when an application is pending with the registry. However, R mark can only be used by the owner of a registered trademark.
So basically, it means TM is when you are in the process of applying for a trademark, while R is at the end of the trademark. Is that what I'm understanding? Is that correct?
Yes. So R is basically when you have received the final certificate, everything is done, then only you can use R.
I did not register my brand name and someone else is using it to sell similar goods. What do I do now?
For unregistered trademarks, there is no statutory protection available. However, there is a common law remedy available, but it is very difficult to get protection from there. So therefore, it is highly recommended to register your trademark at once, since registration serves as a very important evidence that you are the rightful owner of the trademark.
Okay, is it really necessary to get a trademark registered?
If you want protection under the Trademarks Act, then yes. But even if you're not registered, you do get certain remedies, such as common law remedies. But the protection under those common law remedies are not that great as compared to the Trademarks Act.
Okay, thanks Tushar for your time in answering these questions. For a limited time, Marcas is offering free filing of trademark. You just have to pay the government registration fees. More details can be had on www.marcas.in. Thank you very much, Tushar, once again for your time.
Thank you, Ram. Thank you for having me on your show again.
There you have it, folks. Another startup and the story behind its founder. I hope you liked it as much as we did in producing the same. Do check out www.foundersgyan.com/EP53 for all the show notes. I'll see you all next week with yet another startup and its journey. But in the meantime, you do know what this show is meant to do. So go out there and take action on your own startup and have a great rest of the week ahead.